You're the first guest we've had who didn't know that they were going to be on the podcast. Like, we brought you in the room, sat you in the chair. That's awesome. That is, it's funny because I have the word presupposition here. I said, make sure you tell Ronnie, like, because I think I know you better than you're one of the few people we've had in here who I really think I know you better than I know you. Mm-hmm. And so I'm probably going to make a lot of presuppositions about you.
Awesome.
And so I says, make sure you tell him to course correct me when I say stuff about you that's not true.
Okay. Will do.
And I don't know you at all, so.
I'm going to turn off my phone. Yeah.
Okay.
You don't even have to. There's no rules in here. You can leave your phone on if you want it. Oh, where to start?
Is this how we start normally?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Just start rolling.
There's been intense criticism that the show doesn't have a formal start or doesn't have like a jingle.
Who says that?
And we want the show to be more like your eavesdropping for the listener.
Voyeuristic.
Sometimes I do introduction. Today I'm gonna do a little bit of one. We have Cara Hipskind in here from the publishing department. Her boss, who's in charge of everything the world sees about CrossFit Inc., is out on maternity leave, or what did he do?
Yeah, you call it paternity, something like that.
I mean, this
that.
Isn't going to publish for a few days. Just say it, Cara.
He'll be out today.
His wife had a baby. Eric Maciel's here. He makes sure the mics work, and he chooses camera angles. There's four cameras in here. We publish to Apple and to the YouTube.
And the journal.
And this is Matt Bischel. He is the head of CrossFit social media. And Ronnie Teasdale is here, former regional athlete, former affiliate owner. And I want to give you a title now, like Renaissance man, explorer, social experiment, connoisseur, entrepreneur.
I like that.
Thank you.
Is that fitting?
No. X out the entrepreneur part, though. I feel like I'm far away.
Could be a little bit closer.
Since the beginning when you've been involved in CrossFit, I've been fully intrigued by you. I think it's because, like, I live vicariously through you, and I think, like, maybe parts of my life have been the way I think your life is. There was a section of my life that is like your life that I've since left. Maybe not left, but migrated, evolved, flown south from. And now I can see on your Instagram, when I was living that life, there was no Instagram. There was like really no internet. And now I can see you like kind of like doing life, you know? Mm-hmm. And Matt does social experiments too, albeit short ones. He did a...
I think that it's like mixed duration.
he did a short social experiment. So I just want to start like at the beginning. The beginning. Where were you born?
From my mom's vagina, like everybody. Lakewood, California.
Oh, Lakewood.
What you were saying earlier is making sense. I got it. I get you.
That isn't that an answer
That's
that I would give?
That's a Sevan answer, yeah, for really sure. For
where sure. are you from? My mom's vagina. Please tell me you heard me
brothers.
Say that. I know. It's amazing. Is that your sister? Yes, she came from my mom's vagina too. Lakewood, California. Is that in Southern California?
Yeah.
And you're of what descent? What ethnicity are you?
50% Filipino, and then my father is German, Irish, and Dutch.
Okay. And you have amazing skin. You have an amazing body. You're like like you and Brooke. Ants have kind of like the same body. Like I'd take your body with my head and my dick. Right?
I mean, yeah.
You have to be loyal to those two things.
Right.
I think you have great hair. Thanks. That's what I admire most.
So you're German Filipino. Where did they meet? Was it like a war setting or military or?
An amusement park.
No shit. Which
Magic
one?
Magic Mountain.
Wow.
Yeah. Which is now called something else.
Six Flags.
Yeah.
Wow, I didn't even know that. I thought it was Six Flags Magic Mountain.
It's in Valencia, California.
Okay, so you're a California native.
Right. So my mom was born in Hawaii. My dad was born in Michigan. And they met here in California. But then I grew up in Michigan. We moved there when I was two or three.
Okay.
Oh.
And you do you have siblings?
Mm-hmm. I'm the oldest. One brother, two sisters.
Are you still in contact with them?
Yeah, of course.
You guys do Christmas? Are you anything? Are you like Jehovah's Witness? You don't do Christmas or?
When I was in fifth grade, I convinced my family to quit buying each other Christmas presents. The holiday thing, the birthday thing, never really resonated with me.
Even in the fifth grade.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Cara doesn't have a boyfriend though. Anything she says,
just
yeah,
put that out
yeah
there
she
first.
Doesn't do presents and she doesn't have a boyfriend.
Well, but okay. I'm married and we don't really do presents, so.
But, see, but yeah. He did up until that point. Okay. So how did you stumble across that idea of not exchanging gifts on the holidays in the fifth grade?
To me, well, I was the oldest, right? So I was getting shafted with like my younger siblings giving me whatever. So I think it might have been a purely selfish thing, but it just makes way more sense. These gift-giving holidays, or just holidays in general, the whole system of society is the opposite of what I feel is correct. So I see remnants of it when I was a child, just like little sprinkles, not being able to explain to myself why I was the way that I was, but just always being different. So I'm 35 now. I've got a lot of it figured out, but even more of it, I just have questions about, which is cool. I like having unanswered questions.
Like for every question you answer, three more doors open where you don't have answer?
Yeah, I have this thing where I actually don't like pairing answers with questions. I think it kills both of them when you do that.
Hmm. Pairing
What's
answers
an example of that?
With questions.
Well, just take any question. If you put an answer to it, there's no reason to ask the question anymore.
So answer a question with a question?
I think that the human mind always wants to put an answer with a question, right? It's either black or white, or yes or no, or right or wrong. And I think that that's just not how reality works. I think that there's many truths to everything. And it's even just this concept is hard to put into a singular sort of language, right? But everything that I look at, I see it through many different windows. And a lot of them contradict each other. And so to hold all that in your mind is a little bit weird.
Yeah, so
sounds crazy.
Well, so limiting
to try to hold it all in your mind.
It makes me not follow any rules.
Yeah. Is that a Taoist idea? This you know, Lao Tzu said, what is the difference between yes and no? Do you read Taoism? Do you know Lao Tzu?
I haven't studied that. Taoist philosophy's sort of sprinkled in everything though, right?
Right.
I don't remember things. When I read books, they kind of go into my brain and disappear into I don't know. So I have a really hard time remembering authors or any, like, even the titles of books or where but they pop up.
The concepts stay in there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you have a great memory around human movement and motor recruitment patterns and how to move your body and how to show other people how to move their bodies.
I was a good teacher, I believe.
Were? Was?
I got you. No, I am teacher. But.
When is the last time you taught someone how to ride a unicycle? Do you teach someone every day how to ride a unicycle?
I get emails a lot, but
we have a couple of those floating around the office somewhere.
Whoa, and then just like in instant time, there's a picture of me on a unicycle.
The internet.
Eric was getting it before you even thought about it.
Wow.
Eric knows.
You know who has, I loaned a unicycle to Andy Petranek.
Okay. He's not too old to ride a unicycle?
Former owner of CrossFit LA, and I convinced him to buy a better unicycle. So he just got that in the mail last week.
I have two unicycles. I haven't actually traveled more than like 6 or 7 feet.
Mm-hmm.
But what would make Let me ask you this. First of all, the people have told me that the one with the bigger tire is easier to ride. Is that true?
You mean fatter tire or?
No, sorry, taller, the larger diameter.
I think if you get around 20 to 24 inches, that's fine. But if you have the small one, so if you go really small or really big, it's definitely harder.
Okay. And then what would make one unicycle better than another unicycle? You said you encouraged Andy to invest in a better quality one. Is it the metals, the materials, the...
It's the seat. Oh, yeah. So I have a lot of unicycles. I'm looking at a picture.
You're a fucking hoarder. I never expected that.
You got their off-roading?
It's like an armada.
So my biggest one isn't even on here. I have one that's a little bit bigger than this one, taller, that I could ride about as fast as anyone can ride a bike. Not like... like a cruising bike speed, I can cruise on my unicycle. But yeah, you can see there's just differences. These have brakes, and then this one's like a crappy one off Craigslist. These two.
How come we haven't seen any videos of you like eating shit on it? Did you have videos of that?
One when I was learning this guy, and I was in Montgomery Woods. Just off road, and
maybe I did see that one.
I didn't know how to go down hills, so I fell backwards on my elbow. That was it.
Do you do like the parkour type stuff, like hopping off rocks and
no, like I don't. Jazz?
They have that for unicycling.
Yeah, it's so gnarly.
They can hop on this table. It'd be the easiest thing for them. Just they'll ride on like
a slack line
rails. Really?
Oh, it's crazy. Have to talk about slackline. I think there's some heavy shit there. Okay, sorry. So, do you have a dwelling? Do you have a place where you call your home? Like, do you have shelter?
Yeah. Right now, I'm living in West Hollywood.
And is that the place you've been for the last 10 years?
4 or 5.
And is that where these unicycles are?
Most of them. I have storage also. Okay. But, yeah.
You have storage?
It's... Just given to me.
Okay, don't judge him, Sevan. Don't judge him.
Hey, in LA, this stuff, it's important. We don't have a lot of space.
I know. I see you as just being free from these like.
So the reason why I have storage is because I was putting all my stuff in there, and I was going to leave society last year. And then 4 days, I was already putting my stuff in storage and selling all my things. And 4 days before I was supposed to go, I met a girl, and it wasn't like that though.
I've already built a whole story around it. You have a lot of unfucking to do.
I wouldn't change major life plans for a girl for that reason.
Right. Okay.
But the girl that I met was starting a project called the Human Network. So I actually canceled all my plans and I stuck around for this. It's a nonprofit I'm now co-president of with her. And yeah, it's a nonprofit. Been sort of working on.
Is that rainbow real right there in that picture?
How would it be fake?
You know, the filters, you know, your social media guru.
What's the mission of the, what's the project?
We keep on changing the direction. So what I say now might be different. But essentially, we're trying to set up systems for people to participate in that's going in a sort of like the new direction of society that I see it's going in, which is more of a collaborative effort of humanity. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to build a system for people to collaborate with each other better. So right now, we're really focused on pairing up mentors with people that need mentoring, and I think that's the direction we're going. Before, we were going with some really huge concepts that might take many years to develop, but we're going to start with this, building some sort of system for mentors to of any type to get connected to people that need help,
like Big Brothers for anything.
Yeah, because this is the future. This is the society that we want, where we all sort of help each other out and thrive as a 7.5 billion member family.
That's what we have on the planet now?
Something like that.
Wow.
It's definitely north of 7.
Ronnie, you're in this space that if I may be so cavalier, that I feel like I've been in, or that maybe I'm still in, and I try to hide from everyone else knowing I'm in this space. And how do you keep out? I feel like that space has a lot of lunatics in it, or maybe lunatics isn't the right word. Distractions in it. Like you look like you're actually putting your oars in the water and paddling, and like I feel like a lot of people in that space have their oars inside the boat, and they're just letting themselves get tossed around, and that they can be maybe a distraction to people who do have a direction, who do have a mission. Because the space you're in does feel it's so liberating and so free, if I may, that it could. You're clearly a hard worker, and I feel like that space maybe doesn't have a lot of hard workers in it.
Being in LA helps. The sort of person that I feel like you're talking about is living anywhere and just sort of doing mushrooms every day and living in the mountains. And you can't really do that if you live in Los Angeles. And everybody else who lives in Los Angeles is doing big things. So the spectrum that you sort of radiate at when you're living in LA is doing something for the world. Whether you're an artist, an entertainer, a CrossFitter, whatever you're doing, if you're in LA, you're like doing it at a big scale. So I'm around and friends with all these types of people. So I'm not just, you know, sort of sitting.
You're not just floating in the cloud of bliss.
Right.
Is that tempting?
Well, I'm doing exactly what I want to be doing and what I should be doing, you know? So.
Which is?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay,
so
we're going to
maybe
get,
I am
that's
in
our
cloud.
That's our that's our mission
non-answers.
By the end of this podcast. So your family jumps. So you're born in Los Angeles. You move to Michigan. You have three siblings. You're of Filipino and German descent, Maciel Manels, and you're in the fifth grade, and you're already showing some leadership potential by convincing your family not to exchange gifts. What next? Are you playing any sports then?
Hockey. 3 years old.
You so look like a hockey player.
Not even close.
I know.
Sorry, missed that one.
So that consumed my attention from 3 years old till 23.
Skating and hitting the puck around?
Yeah, that was just my number one priority, right? Because I started at three, I didn't know what life was without this thing that I had to do. I had to compete. When I got older, I had to go hurt people and it's just like this part of life that you think is more important than everything else, even because I wasn't in the outside perspective looking and I was in my body and this is all I knew. So that taught me all my life lessons and just how I operate.
When you say hurt them, you mean by beating them at the game or you mean actually physically hurting them?
No, eventually you get to a point where one of the efficient ways to beat the other team is to physically make them incapable of playing. So.
Sounds like wrestling.
Yeah. I mean, well, are you trying? I'm sure you are trying to hurt them physically, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we have sticks and their weapons. So I was the guy on the team that had to do that. That was my job.
The enforcer.
Yeah.
The bruiser.
So I was fighting every weekend.
And getting accolades from it, from your teammates.
Yeah. I mean, fighting in hockey isn't you don't even really get penalized for it. Both people in the fight get the same penalty. It's only 5 minutes. So the team doesn't even get a man down. So I was faster than everybody else because I think I tried harder, the hardest in practice, and I wasn't very good. So all I knew is that I could be faster than everyone, and then because I was faster than everybody, I had a timing advantage. When someone would look over their shoulder and see me, whatever, 15 feet away, they would do a calculation in their head before they got the puck, how soon I would get to them. And these things are happening in sports all the time, right? And you make these calculations and they think they're going to turn and get rid of the puck. Well, I would be there to them 15 to 20% faster than they could calculate. And it would just be really easy for me to, like, that's what I was hoping the whole time, is that everyone would miscalculate the timing. And so I'd catch them off guard, and it would end really badly for them. So my job was to hurt people. And I actually had to quit playing hockey because of that. A couple years ago, I went back and played, like, adult league hockey. And I was fighting every game because this is like the wiring, just like adults, right? But they're picking on me, so they deserved it. I didn't start any fights. I just finished them really quickly, and I had to stop because I was like, okay, this isn't actually who I am anymore. But there was a portion of my life where all I was thinking about was hockey and then what hockey meant to me.
So at 23, you said you had to stop because you were fighting. Why did you have to stop? Because you didn't like it? Didn't feel good?
At 23, my option was continue playing hockey at a professional level or move to California and start fitness. Because if I was that person, I was in the gym all the time to protect my body. So I chose to move to California because I didn't want to just continue.
So there was a chance you were going to play professional hockey.
Yeah, but it's not that big of a deal. Not the NHL is a big deal. But just professional. So the route to the NHL would have probably been for me to play in the minor leagues in USA, then go to Europe, play there, and then maybe if I attain enough skills, come back to the NHL. But that would have, I'm, as the enforcer, not big enough to play in the NHL as that role.
How tall are you?
5'10".
And how much did you weigh back then at 23?
175.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you've always been lean and mean.
It's definitely not an enforcer in the NHL.
Right.
Were there any other people who looked like you in the NHL? Or would you say you're Asian, of Asian descent? Were there any other, not in the NHL, sorry, just in hockey when you played there in Michigan? Did you look different than all the other players?
This is interesting because I never knew how I looked. I don't look at myself. So I don't really know how other people see me. I know I'm not white, but I feel like I don't look any different than a white person. But I know that that's not true.
Yeah, me too. I never even knew I was short till I went to college.
Yeah.
And then I was like, oh shit, I'm short.
When? How? How did that come about?
Because I just remember going to college and like everyone was tall and I would hear people say stuff like, he's short, or like it just became that way. I would see somewhere girls didn't want short guys, or just I was like, oh shit.
It wasn't a thought before that.
Yeah, everyone here is taller than me. It just never ever hit me until. But then I still see myself as white until I go to the airport and they give me the extra pat down. Then I'm like, nah, you're not white. And now I think I look like Ahmadinejad, but I digress.
That's a different.
I had that same thing when I found out that like my family wasn't so wealthy. When I got my driver's license and I started driving to the other malls, and I was like, oh, these malls look different than the mall I've been going to my whole life. Yeah, so that's
like the floors were clean.
Yeah.
Like
people are probably different.
Right.
You're like Macy's, different, not the dollar store. This is weird. Yeah. Did you grow up poor?
I don't want to say that, but we had,
financially speaking,
we
have four kids.
Plywood floors in my house. Oh yeah, my parents are studs. Man, cute. You're good.
Man, your mom is smoking. Look at that! Wow, which one is you on the left?
You're the curly.
Or on the will you touch you on the screen? Yeah, that's one.
So my amazing father built our house, and then I guess we didn't have enough money to finish it or finish the finishing touches. So we had no carpet. We just had plywood floors till I was like 10 or 13 or something. So that was cool because he also built an ice rink in our backyard in the winter times. And so we could walk around the house with our ice skates and we could rollerblade around the house all the time.
That's awesome.
Is he a big dude?
No.
No,
I'm taller than him, actually.
Oh, really? He just looks giant next to your mom?
Yeah. I think he's 5'8", 8-ish, and I'm 5'10".
Do you still have a relationship with your parents?
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. Are they in Michigan?
They live in Hawaii.
Oh.
I just saw everybody a couple months ago. My littlest sister got married in November.
Nice.
So we were in Kauai. Yeah, they live in Hawaii now, on Oahu.
So you decided to come to California at 23. You're like, I'm not going to keep pursuing hockey, and mostly because you didn't like the violent aspect of it.
Yeah.
Okay. So you moved to California. That's 12 years ago. That was in 2006 or 5.
How did you do that math? Did I tell you that?
Yeah.
2006.
2006, moved to
California.
Okay.
Common Core.
And I'm dumb as a box of rocks. So... careful what you say if you think that impressed you. had you found CrossFit yet? Had you heard of CrossFit?
No.
Okay.
No idea. So,
did you know anyone in California?
I had a friend here. My grandma lived here, but I just moved like loan shark style with a motorcycle and 5 pieces of luggage.
Oh, I saw your motorcycle. Is that the rat bike?
That's just the one that I have now.
Okay.
Just sitting there. But I moved with a giant motorcycle.
Okay.
So where was I?
23 years old, came to California.
Yeah. So I immediately got distracted by modeling and acting because I was walking around in motorcycle boots, which made me 3 inches taller than I am. And everyone thought I should be modeling and acting. So it was like a weekly basis, somebody would approach me and be like, I'm an agent, blah, blah, blah. And these are real agents, like Daniel Hawk. Like the agencies that I walked into and had meetings in were the agencies that like represent Lindsay Lohan and like, like
crazy
people that, yeah.
Legitimate people.
Yeah.
People you weren't seeking this. This just came out.
Right. But I didn't realize that acting and modeling is just like everything else. You like have to work at it. And so once I started going on casting calls and realizing that, oh, Bob Harford took those pictures.
With his Leica?
Yeah. You had a conversation with him about that, obviously.
About his Leica, yeah. I remember when he got his Leica. He was so excited.
Actually, I think he
turned me on to Leica.
I don't remember if he took it with that. He might have taken it with a really old camera he has.
And his Leica only takes black and white, I think. He doesn't. Okay, he's like a
then
purist.
He did take it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, Leica.
Hashtag Leica.
All right.
Look at it. He even wrote the name of the lens. That's a pretty
monochrome
baller lens.
He's awesome. I've been friends with him since like the moment I met him. But anyways,
he doesn't like you. He just likes your body.
Exploitation.
I'm projecting.
I eventually started a gym, personal training people. Or no, I started going to a gym. I was paying, actually, to back up even more, a little bit interesting. I have a degree in exercise science and psychology. And I moved to California just thinking I could start training people with that and found out that no, you need insurance. And in order to get insurance, you need to be certified personal trainer. So I had to start taking my test. I had to study the material, take the test. And during that time, I couldn't work. So I was riding around LA on a motorcycle with a foam roller and a yoga mat in my backpack. And going to people's houses and stretching them out, like partner assisted stretches. And
how would people get your name? How did you?
Craigslist, dating, the dating section. Hey man, I had to do what it takes. I had no help living in LA, so I would post on Men for Women, Women for Men, Women for Women. Men for Men, and of course,
talking about like,
I will
that
come
you're
to your house
and stretch and work
stretch
on mobility.
Your ass out, yeah. and this was before I knew anything.
You didn't use stretch your ass out on
Men for Men, did
you? Okay.
I got a few women calling me, but it was mostly men, and a lot of crazy emails and propositions.
Like dudes just expecting a hand job. Hey, I'll give you $100 for a few. Yeah.
Yeah, but you eventually learn to decipher.
Okay.
Yeah, guys asking a variety of things.
I can only imagine that learning curve.
Like, will you train me naked? Will you...
What were your boundaries? Where were your...
So nothing's...
Where would you be like, okay. Those underwear, okay. Those underwear, not okay. Those in the front where I can see your penis, not so much.
Yeah. I've never done anything...
There was zero prostitution involved?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And then any clients I got were legit, right? So if there's money exchange, it was legit. But there is a couple propositions that I almost followed through. Like, a few people wanted me to have sex with their wives. And I was really close to going to one couple's place. But then I'm young, right? So... I was young and I just got nervous and freaked out before I went. So I canceled that.
That's probably healthy to get nervous and freaked out. I had a friend who does do acupuncture, and it's led to some more than needling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think I'm guessing a lot of people do get into personal training for that reason.
Probably.
You know, same reason why people become musicians.
Or pilots. Yeah.
You think pilots are getting
it? So, yeah, it's weird. It's always in my head because I had a girlfriend who worked in the airline industry, and she was telling me that pilots are like the dream guy of all the flight attendants.
Oh,
so
funny.
They're like the rock stars of the flight attendants.
I can see that.
Sevan's about to change his career.
In our office, it's the head of social media. He is just like, he's the king.
We've been trying to keep it under wraps for years.
Okay, so
all the DMs.
You should see these DMs.
I did, I did a lot of my career on Craigslist too, basically saying camera for hire. Mm-hmm. But I didn't, no one ever propositioned me. I would do like bar mitzvahs and weddings and shit like that in clubs and.
And people used Craigslist 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. Now it's kind of not... Craigslist was the only thing around 10 years ago.
Right. Yeah.
So...
I did some editing for some porn, too.
Yeah.
Did you?
For like 2 days. It's not... And I had to quit.
So
I just immediately quit. You can't do it.
Why?
You just did, like, just the whole time, you just want to get up and go fuck someone. Like, you can't, like... You get any work done. I just quit. Sorry. Just took all the tapes back. Sorry, go on.
I did some underwear modeling offline. Also, uh-huh. Which is funny because some of those pictures came up a few years ago.
Eric?
I know Castro's seen some.
Oh.
You think Dave has them in his personal collection?
I know he sent them to somebody who I knew, who then sent them to my friends.
Nice.
And then I saw them and I was like, what the heck?
Are you friends with Dave Castro?
We don't text. We're not on the texting like relationship.
Do you have his phone number in your phone?
No.
Okay.
I don't think so.
But maybe.
Maybe.
Have you ever been yelled at him at the games?
No.
Oh.
But Ryan Fisher
works. But your friends have.
That was, it was not a surprise, though.
Sorry, I want to get us back on track. So, 23 years old, come to California, making a living, studying to become a trainer so that you can get your personal training and get your insurance, and in the meantime, doing some stretching.
Yeah.
And having some cool experiences, interesting experiences. And where are you sleeping at night at this time? Did you have a place, a hostel?
At this time... So I lived in like 5 different places the first 6 months I lived in LA. I was staying on people's couches. And then I got my personal training certificate, and then I was training at a gym, just paying them $15 a session. And when I was there, I met a guy who was like, hey, do you want to make a few hundred dollars every single day in between your clients? And so then he owned a company or ran a company that sold apartments to USC students. So I ended up being a sales rep for all these apartments, managing like 15 apartment complexes and the maintenance staff, and working in the leasing office and doing all, basically a full-time job. And before and after, and I had an apartment through that company. And so within that apartment, I put a squat rack and I started training people in my living room. So I was training people in the morning and at night, and then working in the leasing office and doing all those duties in the middle of the day. And I was making $100,000 with just my personal training clients. And still I was working in the middle of the day because all I was focused on was I want my own gym. So $100,000 is good for me just to live on, but I want my own gym. So all the money I was making, I was buying more equipment and moving into bigger apartments. And then, so I moved from one bedroom apartment to a loft where I had the gym in the loft, and then I lived in the room, and then from there to a two bedroom apartment with the garage, and then from there to like a penthouse loft in downtown LA, I think. And in that place is when I stumbled across CrossFit. And so I had a gym in,
on the internet. Did someone talk to you about it?
No. So the girl worked for the airline industry. She lived in Utah. So she took me into CrossFit St. George. I hope that's the right name.
And which is the town that Brooke Entz's dad built.
Yeah. Oh. He built the entire town. Yeah.
Interesting. Go on.
Really?
Yeah.
So she took me into there, and I was just thinking, like, wait a minute, this is a gym? Because it was in a storage unit, mm-hmm. like a warehouse, like not much bigger than this room. Like mm-hmm. if you just extended this to that wall, that's how big it was. And then they were talking. Oh, so I went in and did the intro workout and did it faster than anyone who's ever done it in the gym before, because I was also just training high intensity. And
do you remember the workout?
Yeah, it was 500 meter row, 40 air squats, 30 push-ups, 20 sit-ups, 10 pull-ups.
Standard baseline, cross the baseline. Yeah.
And then the next day or 2 days later, I went back and I did two workouts, because the baseline workout for me, you know, in the beginning, you're not really pushing as hard as your work capacity is not up high enough where you feel like you're not working out.
Right.
You get, you know, those beginning clients feel like they need to go to the gym after they do a CrossFit workout. Mm-hmm. So I was like that at the time. So then the next time I went, I did two workouts with them. One was, what's the 30 minute Cindy we do on the minute
Chelsea.
Every minute?
Mm-hmm.
So I did that in the morning and then came back and then did DT.
Oh, man.
And DT was with 135 pounds, so I scaled.
And you already knew how to clean and...
No.
No, okay.
So I never cleaned.
Sevan.
Ah.
Never
Excuse
jerked.
Me, your gift has arrived. Do you know this book she's bringing in?
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, Haley.
You don't think I should give it away? Is that what you're saying?
No, I just...
Whoa.
I've seen this before.
Haley, Ronnie Teasdale.
Hello, Haley.
Okay, I mean, thank you.
I've seen that book before, but I don't have it now.
You will shortly. You will own this book. Okay, go on. Sorry. So yeah, I know it's, you're all excited. You're all salivating. Yum, little. This is Ronnie's gift. I'm going to give it to him before he leaves. We'll talk a little bit about it.
So I did DT.
Okay.
Yeah, don't know what a jerk is.
I do.
Takes one to know him. Anyways.
I've seen cleans, but it was really just me wrenching my back up. And then I exploded a testicle.
Ooh.
So
that day when you did the two workouts?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sorry, let me paint this picture a bit. So you're living in LA, you're working your fucking ass off, you're ambitious as all get out, you managing apartments, your personal training, you got a hot chick who is an airline stewardess who gets you free flights to St. George, where you come across a CrossFit gym on your second trip back to St. George. Was she Mormon?
Yeah.
On your second, you're lucky you didn't get her pregnant with 15 kids. And on your second trip back to St. George, you are doing Chelsea in the morning and DT in the evening. And while you're doing DT.
So I go home later that day and she's like, what's, she noticed it. She's like, what's up And then I was like,
like, you guys are hooking up and she knows something's wrong with your testicle?
Yeah, that's the story we can tell. Yeah. So I look down and it's huge. Like, I don't know. Just,
I expected more self-awareness from you. I don't think anyone should be telling me about my testicle before I notice
yeah,
it.
Yeah, so it's funny. When she pointed
like, I got
it
this
out,
pimple on my back that someone pointed out the other day, and I'm like, yeah, I know it's there.
She, when she said something, I was like, I actually did notice that, like, it was, like, sticking to my leg. But I was just, like, on my leg more than normal. But I just wasn't processing it. So I looked down. It was huge. Apparently, it was called varicocele. Mm-hmm. Which basically means all the veins inside there just swelled up. So what it felt like was there was just like a bunch of spaghetti inside my nutsack.
Oh my
did it hurt?
Gosh.
No, not really.
What do you? Oh my gosh, man! You don't even know what the fuck he's talking
okay,
about.
Okay, that sounds gnarly, dude.
Oh my gosh.
It was like all the veins that are there just.
Does that
I could
sound
feel.
Normal to you?
No, like the size of spaghetti.
Normally, it feels like a meatball. And okay. When it turns to spaghetti, you're like, uh-uh.
Got it.
And yeah, so then I was like, okay, this exercise program
is good.
Yeah, it has the ability to break me. So while
are
I
you,
was...
do you think that there was a relationship between doing DT and the spaghetti nut?
Yeah, of course. Oh, okay. Hold
do you
on.
Think the bar hit you?
It
mat,
was his
or?
Second
no, no,
day
no,
doing
no.
a CrossFit workout, and he did two super tough
yeah.
ones.
Yeah.
And it was like 30 rounds of Cindy never doing workouts like that before.
Yeah, okay.
I don't think I...
Did you get rhabdo? Did you pee any chocolate milk? Any Coca-Cola?
No.
Spaghetti?
Just a spaghetti nut. That's like next that's level horrible. Rhabdo.
That's a horrible visual.
So I think that was just like the stress, right? Because with the athletic mindset, I would do anything, right?
Okay.
So they also were talking to me about this thing called regionals, and they're asking me if I was going to regionals, and I'm like, what are you guys talking about?
What year is this?
2009.
Okay.
Because the guy showed me kipping pull-ups, and then I did them, and then the girls in the gym were like, are you going to regionals? And I'm like, what is that? And they're like, oh, it's this thing. It's happening next weekend. And the owner was like, no, he can't go. It's too late. So then the games came on, right? 2009 games. And they're all on CrossFit.com. And so I just was like, I'm going to watch this stuff. And when I was watching the games, because they weren't live, I don't think. They just had the highlights or something. Mm-hmm. I could feel... the heart.
That was him putting that
together.
Did
you do that? Okay, well, here's the full connection, right? It's full circle. When I was watching the games, like Miko Salo, that was his year. The adrenaline rush that I was getting while watching it was the same thing that I would get in a hockey fight. Mm. And I hadn't felt that in years. And so just watching this was stimulating me to a point that I was like, I'm doing this mm-hmm. no matter what, right? So I signed up for my CrossFit level one. And
nice.
I had a choice. I was like, do I get a... I don't even know what this thing is. I don't know what CrossFit is. I just saw it on the internet, and I signed up for level one. And this is the horror story that everybody uses is why we like CrossFit affiliates are garbage, because they just go to a weekend seminar. But that's literally what I did. And I don't think it was a horror story, right? Like, I didn't know what power clean was or any Olympic lifts. I went to a level one seminar without ever being a member at a CrossFit gym. I went to CrossFit St. George a few times, and that was my experience with a lot of these movements. And I had a cable cross machine. I had, like, equipment in my current gym that wasn't serving me, so I sold all that and I bought a rowing machine and some barbells and a set of Olympic plates, and all this was really expensive for me, so I couldn't afford a CrossFit gym membership and all the new equipment. But anyways, I worked it out and got clients who paid me to teach them things as I was learning them also. Mm-hmm. And
you went to your level one in 2009.
Yeah, and 5 days later, I was granted an affiliate. It was like the same week.
And what? And where did you do your L1?
Las Vegas.
And was Zach Forrest there?
No.
No. Do you remember who your the instructors were?
Man, not anymore. One of the guys was the strength, like helping San Diego University.
Josh Everett.
Oh.
No, Josh it was another tall guy.
Stephane Rochet.
Stephane,
yeah.
Very tall.
Stephane. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Were you, what did you think about those 2 days? You've been in sports since you've been 3 years old. You've been moving your body for.
And Sakamoto was there, I believe, also.
20 some odd years. Were you just like, holy shit, I've arrived. This is amazing. Or were you like, this is lame. I know all this.
No, this was the most valuable experience in fitness that I ever had, the level one. And I spent my entire CrossFit career telling everybody that I didn't actually need to know how to do a lot of the movements, but watching the trainers, they were teaching us at a level that I'd never seen anybody teach a group of people at. Mm-hmm. And that's where I was like, as I was there as a teacher, and I was watching master teachers. Mm-hmm. And it was very stimulating for me.
I want to tell everyone who's listening, I know Ronnie Teasdale through the internet. I don't know him like we're shit. When he came to the regionals 2 years ago, I bonded with him. I got very focused on his story, the 3 days he was there. And we built, I would say, a friendship, although short, very quickly over a three-day period. And no one, and I've never talked to him about the L1, and the L1 was probably one of the most profound experiences I've had in my life in terms of what it did for my movement. And we don't coach anyone before they come in here on the podcast, and it's just great to hear you say that, because it's like, it's crazy. I was just talking to Greg Glassman about this last night. It's truly like, I mean, for us, it's an amazing, like, life-changing experience. But even like when you have kids, you're gonna be able to teach them all of that and pass that down. And it's just like, and I've said this before, just like swimming is an inoculation against drowning, CrossFit is sort of an inoculation against taking your L1 against chronic disease and having longevity and learning how to move and just taking some really basic rudimentary skills that you're going to carry with you your whole life, right? Mm-hmm. And it doesn't mean you have to do CrossFit your whole life. It doesn't mean like, you can even turn your back on CrossFit and say, fuck you. But I'm telling you, those 2 days are going to be like, wow. Mm-hmm. Anyway. Would you say that's fair that about our relationship? And I've only DM'd back and forth with you over the last year.
Right.
Okay. There was no prep. You didn't even know you were going to be on the podcast when you walked in. You are one of the only people. We get a lot of DMs, people asking what that is. And now that you've been touching it and playing with it on the show, people are going to know. But no other guest has ever fondled the black rod. I'm really glad you feel comfortable enough touching the black rod.
I feel
rod.
Like I want to invest in some stock in that company after this publishes.
The black rod. Okay. So you do your L1, and it's so inspiring for you that you're like, fuck this, I'm opening an affiliate. I want to share this. This is like the...
Yeah.
But you were already on a plan to open a gym anyway.
I mean, I already had a version of a gym.
In your apartment?
Yeah. No, by this time I was on penthouse level. It was legit. Penthouse level in downtown LA. And so that's another thing, is that I already had a functioning gym with clients when I found CrossFit. So going into CrossFit, I wasn't following like the dogma of CrossFit, because it wasn't necessarily, it definitely evolved everything that I was doing, but I was already doing something.
Right.
So
hardcore, successful.
Yeah. So it wasn't like the end all be all. And then also, this is when there's a lot of stuff going on in the CrossFit world, like the Rob Wolf, that whole debacle happening right around this time. And
drama.
Which is crazy, because then I was watching all that, and then he came back. He came back around a couple years later and attacked me. But anyways, that's what he had to do.
No reason to attack Ronnie Teasdale.
That's what he had to do. It was his journey. But
he's a humble man we can all learn from on the unicycle adventure. Do not attack Ronnie Teasdale.
So
I bet you that mustache took you 6 years to grow.
This is the longest I've ever had my facial hair. Yeah, I've been shaving like clean my whole life.
How long did that take you to grow?
6 months.
Oh, that's wow.
I think
that's
it's
not
5 or 6 months.
Wow, that's not.
It wasn't from this. You've been growing it since that picture.
I mean, you have the kind of skin that looks like you couldn't grow hair on it. Like, if like, do you have armpit hair?
I barely. Like I.
Oh yeah, that is barely.
I started growing armpit hair when I was 19. So. Yeah. I don't know if it was because I don't have hair or.
What did you? You but you had hit puberty before 19, like.
I don't know about that. I think, yeah, because I was having sex with girls. But
the defining characteristic of puberty for me is when you start ejaculating, right? Is that accurate, Matt?
Okay. Then I hit puberty.
I don't know.
Okay, when do you finish puberty?
I told you.
I don't know. I just think it's like just a moment. Like one day you're shooting blanks, and then one day you're shooting stuff, and you're like, all right, I hit puberty.
That's like puberty. Yeah, I feel like it's like the voice change.
Voice, height.
Yeah.
Like
you start getting all googly in hair. Your body, and you like kind of break out. Like that's
so it's like a people. It's not a moment. It's a.
I mean, maybe
it's not.
That's
it's not binary.
You,
it's a window.
Well, I think there is a hit puberty moment. But then it's got a finish, right?
I'm still going through it. If I still get pimples, am I still going through it?
Yes.
All right.
The answer is always yes.
All right. Don't ask questions. Okay. So 5 days later, you open an affiliate.
Yeah, and I went into the CrossFit world sort of with a bunch of other people in the CrossFit community. It seemed like was very dogmatic about everything CrossFit was doing, but on a daily or weekly basis, I was going to Santa Monica Beach and hanging out at like where all the acrobatic people hang out on by the rings, and people are doing one-arm handstands and doing incredible things that were more incredible than a two-minute Fran, right? I'm all two-minute Fran is pretty incredible, but they were still also doing other things other than thrusters and pull-ups. So I always had this other influence because I had respect for circus, art, and all this other stuff. So
parkour,
human movement.
Yeah.
Parkour is amazing.
I had parkour classes at my CrossFit gym until someone broke their leg.
We need to have Ronnie back. We need two podcasts with Ronnie.
So yeah, I just went in with a very open-minded viewpoint. I followed main site for 6 to 8 months, and my clients did main site, and then I started programming my own stuff and doing my own stuff. And
you would scale main site for beginners?
Yeah.
Wow, that's so profound. Well, I'm making fun of people out there who don't realize you can fucking scale, like, you know, and you could scale for old people?
I think so.
Young people, everyone. I mean,
it works
this,
both ways.
This I'm trying to set up. Sorry, I'm trying to do propaganda with you. I should know better.
I had a good question too. And
okay, sorry, go ahead.
I just say, what was the intrigue of doing your own programming?
Well, it eventually. So the first place I was in, we didn't run 400s because I lived on the penthouse. So we would run 11 flights of stairs, like down and up. And so that lead me to like, okay, I have a different sort of gym and I need to program for the appropriateness of this space and the equipment I have. And that was really the thing. So we would like run up a flight of stairs and do exercises at every level, you know, instead of, it was just little differences like that. But then when I first got into CrossFit, I was taking all the seminars, the Olympic weightlifting seminar, gymnastics seminar, all the seminars, because I needed to learn this stuff as quickly as possible. That's just how I operate. I knew I wasn't as knowledgeable as I should be. So I was taking lots of seminars. I took my level 2 seminar like 2 or 3 months after taking my level 1. And I think only 3 people passed in that. That was at the time when level 2s were actually a test.
Yeah.
And 3 people passed and I was one of them.
Are you smart?
Yeah, but it's weird. I don't think my brain operates functionally because there's a lot of brain damage that's happened through hockey. And then also when I was in fifth grade, I
gave up Christmas.
I rode my bike into a brick wall going like faster than you can ride on a bike because it was going down a hill.
Jeez.
And
Matt did that to his social media account. He ran into a brick wall, but total different story.
Were you wearing a helmet?
No.
Whew.
So I think that...
we're going to take a commercial break.
Yeah.
Okay.
Earn some money, pay our sponsors.
Oh, you want to take a break, Sevan?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we'll be right back. So you're taking all the seminars. You want to know everything there is to know.
And I don't remember what I was talking about.
We're just talking about the beginnings of your affiliate. You were the level two, only three people passed your class. Mm-hmm.
You started taking the gymnastics and the Oli courses.
Yeah, so then I was on the top level doing Olympic lifting. And I was shaking the entire building because we were dropping weights on the top floor. And I eventually decided that I needed to move. So something I kind of skipped over is that I use a fair amount of what would be considered magic to operate in this reality. So
even back then you did that?
Yeah. I started at 19.
Okay.
I started seducing girls in their dreams.
What?
This is the more interesting stuff than my gym, but this is CrossFit HQ, so we gotta talk about the gym stuff.
I can't wait. Fuck the gym stuff. At 19 years old, let's go back in time a little bit here, Ron.
Okay.
Put your feet up, relax. Listen to my voice. At 19, you're living in Los Angeles? No, you're living in Michigan still playing hockey, and someone teaches you about magic?
So the reason why I mentioned this is because I was about to talk about how I created the facility that Mean Streets was in for the majority of the time, and that was like a scenario that I just sort of popped into existence. But let's go back.
I do want to say one thing for Cara and Matt. Everything he says now, moving forward about magic and seducing women, Eric will immediately become a practitioner of. I'm so fucking scared. I don't want you fucking going to Haley's dreams. You hear me, motherfucker?
Copy.
Can't you see Matt?
Eric's all
excited.
You just caught him red-handed, too.
Okay.
I'm taking notes right now.
So 19 years old, living in Michigan.
Mm-hmm. And I was going to school for psychology.
Okay.
And exercise science, but psychology was the major. And I was completely fed up with the college experience. I didn't buy any textbooks. So I was just going to class, listening to teachers, passing the test, going home and studying my own psychology. And of course, at 19, I had a girlfriend at the time. So just, I wasn't...
Were you a lady killer? Were there a lot of women jocking you?
No. There are now.
Oh, I know. I could tell.
Things are flipped. So for the first 12 years of dating, I was in 4 3-year-long relationships. And then there's a now. But back then, so I just mentioned that I had a girlfriend at the time when I was studying all this stuff, and it was purely intellectual, but it worked. And instead of buying books and reading the stuff the teachers were telling me to read, because by this time, you know, I was into conspiracy theories and just the whole stuff that people eventually get to when they start realizing the stuff they're taught in school is all bullshit. So I was going through that when I was 19. And I was going home, and the interesting topic for me was male-female relationships. And how psychology, because that was my interest also, how psychology has to do with that. And so I was studying about all of those dynamics and just getting into deeper and deeper and deeper levels. And meditating eventually comes up. And so I'm starting to do that.
Who were some of the authors that led you to meditating?
Again, I don't know.
I mean, was it more commercial stuff like Deepak, or was it more like old Krishnamurti, Auspensky? Like
who? Like all the people that everybody knows, I don't know these people.
Was it Buddhism?
I ended up getting into not at that time.
Okay.
But I, so like to give you some names, we got Manly P. Hall.
Just some of the early books. I'm trying to think of like what you, how does that happen? Like someone doesn't just all of a sudden turn to meditation. Someone says, hey, have you ever thought of sitting still and watching your thoughts? And you go, huh? And you know what I mean? Like there has to be like a.
I know. I'm trying to think. So I was actually into. I was studying everything.
Wow. I swear to God, you should go into acting. You should dump all everything you're doing. You could be the next Johnny Depp. Look at you.
This was right when I first moved to California, because this is a throwback.
Throwback hashtag.
So this is actually before the penthouse thing.
You look like Christian Hissoy. You guys know who that is?
This looks like it's right in the middle of the penthouse experience.
Is that a modeling picture or that's real? Those are your friends. That's
no, this is a modeling picture.
It is.
But this is like motorcycle I had.
Those are some heels.
Okay, so 19 years old, you're getting into by the way, if you're listening to this, you gotta just switch over to YouTube now and see some of these pictures.
We are becoming a visual podcast.
19 years old, you're
so the thing that people can look into is this thing called psychic seduction. And so there is this technique that had a profound impact on me. And
bookmarking stuff.
Earmuffs, Eric.
And what it taught me was several. So when you start studying about women, you actually, like, this is just a version of life, a pretty important version of it's a pretty important aspect of life. So how you are as a person and how you are inside and how you think about yourself, these are all important things. So when you're studying about these things, these are actually, it led me down these topics. And this particular guy, I don't know if he developed it or what, but it's trademarked color entrainment technique. So I want to mention what it is before I start talking about. I used a version of it and I don't use it anymore, but at the time it helped me. Color entrainment technique does is you meditate your brain to the frequency of the earth. So then you're vibrating at the frequency of the earth. And then from this point, you can access all the other channels, which is basically everybody and everything on the planet. So if you do this at night, focus on a female friend and go into her sort of kind of have to.
How do you know her color or her frequency?
So what happens is you start.
Like, what if you end up in your sister's frequency?
I'm gonna give you like the 60-second version of what you're gonna do.
Okay.
So you take the colors of the rainbow or the colors of the chakra, red, orange, yellow. Man, I'm trying to think about too many things, so I can't even think of this right now. What is it?
Red, orange, yellow, green,
blue. So red, orange, yellow, green, blue. So you'd focus for 30 seconds to 60 seconds as on everything in your mind's eye of the color red. So red Corvette with red tires, with red rims, with the red road. You open the trunk and there's a red engine with red oil spilling everywhere. And all of a sudden the Kool-Aid man comes in and he's all red and he's pouring red all over. And you're just thinking red, 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 30 seconds to a minute. And then you switch to orange and you're just, everything's orange. You're imagining yourself peeling an orange and the inside of the orange is orange and you're eating it and just everything's orange. Orange grass, orange trees, orange sky.
Are you orange?
Yeah. So you're getting your, because colors have frequencies, right? So what you're doing is you're tuning your resonance to the frequencies of the colors and you're starting closer to where you're just normally operating in waking state and you're taking yourself down to dream state. So you do this with orange, then you go yellow, then you go green, then you go blue, then you go purple. And by this time you're like really like these the frequencies of these lower colors in this spectrum, as I'm considering them lower, is is closer to how the earth is vibrating. And then I would imagine myself at the top of 21 stairs, and then I'd walk down the 21 stairs, and as I'm walking down, it gets blacker and blacker and blacker and blacker and blacker. At the bottom of the stairs, again, I'm trying to keep this really short, so I'm skipping over. Well, no,
you're good. This is the main thing. You have my attention.
Then at the bottom of the stairs of this blackness, there's a door. And the door could be made of anything, but you just imagine a door. And you walk through the door, and this is, you're basically lucid dreaming by this point. And I could tell that this was working because through this process, I could feel my eyes going nuts, like just going nuts. So for me, I felt like I was going into rapid eye movement. And my eyes and face would go nuts. And
Hold on one second. Do you walk yourself through this process? Is there something you listen to that walks you through it?
No, so you have to remember it. Remembering the colors was the difficult part for the beginner, but that's really easy.
So you walk yourself through it and just try not to fall asleep during the process?
Yeah.
Okay.
You go into this dream world, and then you can be flying over mountaintops or on the beach, whatever. But for me, it was always like mountainous area, very clean, green. And I was always on the mountaintops. And so then you would find said girl there. So you wouldn't like, you just like a lot of this stuff, which I've learned over the last years, it's not that complicated. Whatever you want, you just focus on the feeling of that thing. So from here, you can sexually seduce girl, and it's real. She feels it energetically somehow.
Like brush her hair, rub her back, walk, hold her hands and walk through the grass, fly around with her, shit like that?
Yeah. And then?
Kiss her neck.
Keep on going.
Does it have an, is it like a wet dream?
No.
No.
But you do go as far as you want, right? Then you come out of it.
Did you ever see anyone else while you're doing that? Oh, and it's, sorry, I digress.
No.
Okay.
No, I haven't.
Okay.
Yeah, let me finish the story.
Sorry.
I'm curious where this is going. Sorry.
So I am shy because I think that I'm always thinking about different things than other people are thinking about. So I only talk to people that I talked to people when I was like kind of like confident that we could vibe. And so I really would just I wouldn't talk to people ever. I would just be really shy. So this was my method of attaining girls through like my younger years, is I would do this and then they would just come to me in real life, in reality. They would come to me and approach me and ask for whatever.
So you would see someone in a class, you've never talked to them before, she's three rows over, she's there every day, she's pretty, and then you just like, fuck it, I want to meet her. So then you go into your dream, you go into this state, this deep meditative state, you see her on the mountaintop, and then 4 days later you're in class, she says, hi, I'm Sally, do you have a pencil?
Right, just like that.
And then you just start
right
the relationship.
So...
Oh, sorry, are you shy, Cara?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I haven't talked for the last hour.
No, but in general, do you?
But I like the way that you said that. I relate to like thinking that I'm thinking something other than other people are.
Mm-hmm.
So I know what you mean by that.
I mean, couldn't you just call it daydreaming?
Call it paranoia.
Thinking about a girl that you're interested in.
Oh, that. Sorry, I thought you were talking about their shyness. But you are shy as a person.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely.
You got to fix your mic, I think, a little bit, because I think I might start talking to you here in a minute.
Okay.
So, this eventually you can also use it to affect yourself. So if you're sick, you can open up the earth, like imagine some sort of hot spring, and then step inside of it, and then just take all of the sickness out of you, like it's just pulling it out of you in like the form of like you just see black going into the water, and then you step out of it and then close it up. And so this was my portal into like, this was my first like, whoa, there's a whole nother dimension of what we call reality that like this is real because this stuff was working.
Do you tell any of these women later on that, hey, our relationship started with blah, 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 XYZ, you being a part of my practice?
No. So this practice has evolved to me being able to do everything this way, not just women. Like, I'm very good at, I don't have to do this thing anymore. I feel like I'm just there all the time. So if I need or want anything, it just appears in front of me. And this is why I don't work anymore. Like, I just was like, all right, I don't need a gym anymore because whatever I want will be provided for me. Why work for it? And that's how I attained the gym, was through this whole thing. Is I just, every step of the way, everything that I needed was just coming at me.
Is that
because you were visualizing it?
Yeah, but it's more than a visualization. It's realizing that you have control. And so what I'm explaining to you is a very immature 19-year-old mindset of, like, let's gather up some girls for myself.
Right.
Right.
I mean, it all has to start somewhere, right?
So through, because that's
vital to the existence of humanity.
Right.
Men and women. Men gathering women or women gathering men.
Right.
Okay. I don't want anyone belittling that activity.
Yeah. Okay. You're right. So I just use the word immature. It's not really
immature is okay, though. Immature is okay.
Yeah,
I just don't want to belittle. Immature is fine.
Underdeveloped.
Right. And that eventually developed to all sorts of...
Why didn't you use that to win the regionals?
Well, I used it to get to regionals.
Okay.
And to me, that's all I really want to do. I'm super injured. So getting to regionals was good enough for me, always. And I don't know if you know or heard stories that I never really trained for CrossFit most of the year. Because, so in this shoulder, I have 3 torn labrums. In this shoulder, I have 3 torn labrums. I have an exploded disc, C7 or C6, one of those, that killed the nerve that goes down into this arm. So this entire arm is malfunctioning, which makes all the overcompensation in this arm. Like, everything hurts in this arm.
Like, torn in 3 different places?
Yeah.
Oh, gotcha.
So 6 labrum tears. And then...
I was like, he has more labrums than me.
Yeah, I was like, I think I have one.
And then I've got a dead nerve in this knee, so this quadricep doesn't fire. Like, if you look at my quadriceps, my right one is actually way smaller than my left. I'm wearing pants right now, so you can't see. And then just all the overcompensation. My neck pinches my nerve every time I do handstand push-ups. So I didn't really do CrossFit, which is why you see me doing all this other weird stuff.
Going back to your, we'll come right back here. The testicle, how did you end up getting that fixed?
It just fixed itself.
Oh, it did. You just looked it up online and it says this will go away.
No, I eventually had to go to a nurse, a care center of some sort, I don't remember. And she was just like, yeah, this is what it is. As long as you don't stress yourself out, it'll go away. So...
And both your testicles are back to normal?
I mean, I don't have any kids, so I don't...
Right.
They're normal enough, yeah.
Are you going to...
duties that
one's not the
for.
Size of a grapefruit anymore.
Are you going to have kids?
I don't think I'm here to have kids, no. However, I will inseminate. I don't think I'm here to raise a family and to be the father. I'm open to providing... semen. My whole version of, like, the family unit and the individual household, I don't really agree with. I feel like we're disconnected from how humans are sort of supposed to operate.
Have you read Hermann Hesse's Siddhartha?
No, but I have it.
Yeah, you gotta read
it
that.
It keeps on coming up.
Yeah, you gotta knock someone up if you read that.
Okay.
But please be open to the fact of raising the kid, because it's so fun, especially when you get older. Oh, my God. I have 3 kids now. I'm having a blast.
Yeah, I'm open.
Oh, my God. It's like having a pet monkey. It's amazing.
They're your clones.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, and I've been biologically, like, reprogrammed to – it's great.
Your story on Instagram with them is always entertaining.
Well, thank you.
They're getting into everything.
Yeah, it's
turning on the oven.
They're little climbers.
That's probably not a good job. Or good good idea.
So you start this practice at 19, and are you scared at how well it's working? Do you ever feel like, and why don't you tell the women that you've met that you use that practice?
So I didn't use it on all of them, just a few throughout the last 15 years, and it's worked every time. However, I don't use it for that mostly. I was using it to just when you have this sort of power, really quickly comes responsibility. And I think that's the greatest thing that I learned, was that when you realize you have control of everything, then you start to feel responsible for everything in your life. Everything that's affecting you is no longer something else affecting you. And this technique that I'm talking about was just one of the many other philosophies and things that I came across. But once you have this control and power, you can't complain about anything ever, because you created it. Like, I asked for it. It's here for me, right? So it doesn't matter if...
It comes with that realization.
Yeah.
Are we all doing that and we just don't know it?
Yeah.
You've just taken more control of it.
Well, the only way to have godlike powers is to realize that everything you see is happening through you. And so that means no complaining about the president, no complaining about the genocide, no complaining about anything, because it's all happening perfectly as it should, determined by your present state of consciousness. There's a lot of bad things happening, right? And it seems like the appropriate thing to do, to complain about and to shed light and to say we shouldn't do that. But we're all participating in it. Like this, we are a fractal of everything. Like this iPhone that you have. An 8-year-old Chinese kid built that thing for you, right? For like $1 a month, they're paying them. And so we are the dirty parts of the earth that we look at and we say, that's bad. That is us, right? So the things that are happening to us, or the things that are happening that seems like that war over there has nothing to do with me. No, it does. Because the parts in your phone, or the diamond that you wear on your wedding ring, or the crystal that you think is so spiritual that you meditate with, like some guy went into a cave, probably by force, to dig that up in 120 degrees so you can have it and think that you're a spiritual guru with it. But we're participating in it all. So the way to change the world and everything is to really just focus and hone in on your own self. So yeah, I feel like we're all participating in this hologram of existence. We're all co-creating it all. And we can prove it by just looking at our stuff. Like, we're all wasting everything that we have. Right now, we all own a whole bunch of stuff and we're using a fraction of it currently. Just like we're just going all over the earth and burning up forests and killing animals and doing everything that we do that we say is wasteful. You know, you see the memes on the internet about we're wasting everything. We're individually a reflection of that. I kind of just went on some tangent and said some things that I didn't really explain. But but the point is that the only way to take control of your reality is to realize that you're creating it all, even the bad stuff. Quote, bad stuff. There's no really such thing as bad. And once you do that, it frees you to be the sort of, to have the God power in everything.
Is complaining arguing with reality? Is that the same thing? Do those?
So when you're complaining, you're refusing to see your participation in reality. You're putting it on somebody else who doesn't exist.
Is that your dog?
No, that's my childhood best friend's dog. I was staying at his place last night.
Is it a pit bull?
I think so.
Do you if you had a dog, what kind of dog would you have?
Something.
actually pretty cute.
The tongue wants in on it. What are you doing?
Oh, hey, watch out.
We're looking at Ronnie's Instagram.
So wolves actually find a lot of information through the breath, which I thought about after I posted this video.
Oh my gosh, he's really trying to get in there.
And the dog's name is Bogart?
Yeah.
I heard that you do that instead of brush your teeth. You let that dog lick your teeth. Is that true?
Oh.
I heard you do that instead of flossing.
Is this practice of yours in any way dangerous?
So,
for your own being.
I know that there's been a lot of people throughout history that talk about similar things and lead mass suicides and like they're all saying the same thing. And even kids that shoot up schools say similar things also. And I think these people chose to go a route where they're rejecting the system that they're sort of forced to be in. And so they want out. And so it can be dangerous because we're all forced to be living in the old paradigm that was set up hundreds of years ago. And we're all of a different consciousness now because our consciousness, it evolves. Like humans weren't always able to think about themselves as separate from each other. Right? Like there was a point where man was in the forest and he thought the forest was like his right arm, right? And if he needed medicine or nourishment, he would reach out and the forest would provide for him. If he needed answers, he would meditate and go into the forest. And there was a version of ourselves where we didn't see the relationship of separateness. And then we evolved in consciousness, just like a baby does if you have children. So through studying psychology, there's a point where the infant doesn't know the difference between itself and its parents. And it thinks when its parents feeds them, it's the same thing as it feeding itself. So it tries to figure out how to manipulate, like how do I get those things to put food in my mouth? So it does things like crying. And then when you feed it, it's like, okay, I need to cry to get food or whatever signals it does. And then they reach an age where they realize they're separate from their environment. And this is like around the age of 2 when they start throwing everything around because they're like, they realize they can manipulate the thing that's different than them, which is their reality. So man has gone through a similar consciousness and we've been shifting our levels of consciousness throughout this whole time. We went from like no separation to believing we are separate to manipulating the environment and using it. And this is kind of where we are right now, right? And this is all good because right now we're in a very individualized sort of like very strong independent beings. And that's our nature. That's how all the system was set up. In the Western world and in the capitalism sort of world, the masculine dominated world, we're very strong individual units. And that's good because that's going to serve us for the next stage of consciousness when we all start collaborating together. The next stage of the ascended version of ourselves is a collaborative effort of the individual components. So all the war and all the dominating aspects that we've seen ourselves do to each other is going to serve us when we start collaborating because we've developed technology, we've developed things that are going to help us collaborate better. So through our individualism, we will now be a bunch of beings on the planet that will collaborate together. And this is the ascended version of consciousness. And this is already happening. So that phone, back to the phone, the internet is a web. So we have now a global collective consciousness. As a doctor learns something in New Delhi, or wherever in the world, we can be learning it at the same exact time. And we explain that story to ourselves with technology. We say, oh, it's coming through the phone, and someone invented the phone, so it's making it happen. This is how I'm receiving this information. But we take the story of technology out of it. We have, like, we're an individual entity here learning the same thing that somebody's learning on the other side of the planet. This is the new human. And we have access to these powers.
It's the old human too, though. It's always been like that, hasn't it? It's just people becoming aware of it.
So we've chosen to separate ourselves from that, right? If you go into tribes, they have the same abilities. They telecommunicate with themselves, just like we send text messages to somebody. If somebody in their tribe is stuck under a log at the waterfall, they, like, the rest of the tribe will know that. They just tune in and get that message. It's this is happening.
Do you roll with people who have the same practice as you?
Yeah, and I love talking to people that don't. I was just talking to a SpaceX. I had a debate with a SpaceX rocket engineer a week before that Falcon Heavy launched. So he was like, in 7 days, this 4 rockets is going to launch a Tesla into outer space. And he's one of the guys that built the engines. And this is like the smartest 23-year-old kid I've ever met in my life. And he was highly, highly solid in science, the scientific mindset. And so when I was talking about this stuff, he would argue with me. And he would argue with why I was saying was wrong. And I would respond with, I agree with you also. Like, everything he was saying to me, I was agreeing with and fitting his arguments into, like, this is how I see what you're, the exact same thing you're seeing, saying, this is how I see that. And then he would argue something else and I would agree with him. And it was just like, cause he was 23, right? So he knows a lot about science cause he has to, he puts stuff into outer space. But like I was saying earlier, reality has many different windows to look at it through. So what is right on this version of reality is also right in different ways through many other windows.
I find it hard that anyone could argue with anything you're saying unless they were a practitioner. Do you know what I'm saying? It's like you're saying, hey, go down to the end of that dark cave right there and there'll be a glass of water. And everyone's like, no, there's not. It's like, hey, we don't have to argue it. Just go down there. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Like, we're standing at the front of the cave arguing. There's no point in standing at the front of the cave and arguing. Just go down there. I was already down there. I drank from the water. You're welcome to go down there. It's all good.
I mean, you just, that's mm-hmm. how most of my conversations go. Yeah. But a lot of people listen. I'm creating a reality where a lot of people enjoy
Eric this conversation. Is listening.
This.
Are you still practicing CrossFit?
No.
You're not.
So,
don't you miss the intensity, the sweat, the meditative heavy breathing,
So there's one thing that my body doesn't feel good because I went into CrossFit with a bunch of injuries that I didn't pay attention to, so I made them worse.
Oh right, okay. From super high level hockey fighting, yeah. and
just not just. Thing everything that happened to me, like, I didn't go get anything checked out, and so, like, the sprained ankles I got when I was a kid just developed into malfunctions in my legs, and mm-hmm. so, and I still, like, if I went to go see physical therapists, they would take a year probably to work on me. Just everything is sort of out of alignment. Do I still practice CrossFit? That's an interesting question because CrossFit is.
And he said it's an interesting question. That's close.
Oh god, I thought it was like tapping on the mic or something. Like yelling at Paramesh. Sorry, go on.
The whole concept of CrossFit is to evolve yourself in as many different aspects of fitness as possible, right? So that you are the most capable specimen to perform whatever you need to perform on any given day. And
let your DNA represent.
Yeah, just constantly varying everything. Mm-hmm. And so very early on, I went to slacklining, and then because I didn't want to get 1% better at doing a thruster when I've already done hundreds or thousands of thrusters.
Makes sense. Got it.
So why don't I start brushing my teeth with my left hand? Because I'm very bad at that. Like, right. Why am I going to spend a year trying?
Have you ever hurt yourself doing that?
Doing what?
Brushing your teeth with your left hand. I dabble in that. It's fucking dangerous.
Like, yeah, you stab your
it's yeah, fucking
you
dangerous.
With the, if it's yeah. the head of the brush.
Yeah, that shit's no joke.
It's just slower.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's because you have a brain. When you're like me, you think you pick it up with your left hand, you think you're going to do it just as fast with your right hand, and shit can go wrong. Just jab yourself in the gum.
I've drawn blood.
Yeah, using your left hand.
Because it gets to the point where you're like, all right, I just need to think that I'm as good with it as... But I actually only brush my teeth with my left hand now.
Okay.
So this is just an example of how, like, through the CrossFit philosophy, it almost took me outside of fitness. Because now, like, really, I've been to regionals, like, 6 times. I don't need to do that stuff anymore. I'm already one of the best. And why continue doing something you're already good at? So now I'm outside of the realms of fitness. And I'm, like, even... So the left-handed thing's one thing, and I've also attained the ability to just intend myself to be fit. Before, I was intending myself to be competitive in CrossFit because I owned a gym. So I was just intending to get to regionals, and that's what happened a lot. Always a shock to me. I didn't know how I was even getting to regionals because I never trained for it. And I had people who worked for me, like, Fisher used to work for me, and he would accuse me of going to the gym at midnight and working out and training because he said I would never work out, or I would tell him I would never work out, and he would be like, dude, you're so on point.
Have you read Stranger in a Strange Land?
Yes. Okay. So my core group of friends were we call each other the Water Brothers.
Okay.
So this is one of my favorite books.
Okay, I want to tell you one more thing before we get on there. When you were in the 5th grade, you ran your bicycle into a wall.
Yeah.
And you did some head damage.
Uh-huh.
What was that head damage?
So.
Did you have a subdermal?
You guys are like twins.
Did you have a subdermal? Yeah, did you know that I crashed my bike at 7 and I spent some time in the hospital?
No, but I think I have.
You didn't get into my dreams last night, did you?
No.
I don't want you in there, Ronnie. I want to see you on the mountaintop.
If they told my parents what happened to me, they didn't make it known to me. I never asked what exactly happened. However, I do have issue. I have to pay really close attention to my testosterone levels. So I have to do everything in my life to maximize testosterone efficiency, because I think that rattled the mechanism that...
Hypothalamus?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's one of them. The hypothalamus controls everything. It goes hypothalamus, pituitary gland, and...
That releases the testosterone?
Yeah, but I don't think it's that. I think it's the mechanism that comes back to tell the brain, like, hey, we need more. That's not working. Because I went and got checked before CrossFit, and they're like, yeah, you have the amount of testosterone that a 70-year-old male had. And this was when I was, like, 24. So that always made me be as healthy as possible. Like, I don't eat soy. Grapefruit is actually something I don't really consume because it increases estrogen. I don't know if that's the right terminology. Maybe it just holds in more estrogen. I don't know. But
it tastes like ass.
I
love grapefruit.
Of course you do.
Grapefruit sucks.
What?
It's in a coli rich environment.
That's not grapefruit. That's
so I think that's right. I think there's some brain thing. And then not to mention that every time I'm thinking about something, I don't know what the end of the sentence is going to look like. And I go into tangents a lot because I think that the wiring isn't stable and it's just sort of like firing in all directions.
God, that resonates with me.
I have that, but I don't think it's like that at all. I think it's because I'm a fucking mad genius who lives in the present and just pulling shit down from the ether.
Yeah. But
Water Boys, uh-huh. Stranger in a Strange Land. Water Brothers. Water Brothers. Did you?
I need to mention the Water Brothers, by the way. So we got Matt, Donnie, and Powers. So these are my three homies.
Is it Matt Powers?
No, it's Timothy Powers. So Powers is his own person, and then there's Donnie and Matt.
Earlier, I offered you a cup of coffee, and you said you hadn't. You've only had like 5 cups of coffee in your whole life. Mm-hmm. So you're on the straight and narrow.
Yeah, I'm pretty disciplined just by nature. I always just wanted to follow the rules, and then I did. I was very good at following the rules, and then it was like massive disappointment after massive disappointment of what following the rules gets you. And so then I started making my own rules.
Are you vegetarian?
No, but I've been vegetarian for... I was vegetarian most of last year, just to do it. And then I was vegetarian 10 years ago, vegan, raw vegan, 10 years ago for like a year also. It's wow. Nothing's dogmatic though. So I just eat the best stuff for me. So anything that I consume. So I know I never drink this stuff, but I didn't see any regular water and I was thirsty.
We don't drink any regular water here.
We have a filter.
Still water, what's that?
So I just, everything I consume is good for me.
Will you ever go a whole day without spending money? Without exchange of currency?
Yeah.
You do. Most people don't. I don't think I do. I think I spend money every day.
Oh, I try to go at least 4 or 5 days every week.
That's just because I'm cheap. Yeah, that's good. That's good.
The human network.
It's a great practice.
Yes.
To try to go without exchanging currency.
Money for me. I don't think about it as anything really tangible. Like for me, I'm not, because if you think about it, I moved to California and all I did was work out for 10 years. And then I ate whatever I wanted, bought whatever car I wanted, did whatever I wanted, went on vacation whenever I wanted. The money thing, like money equals this thing, I didn't insert that into the program. I was doing what I wanted and then doing what I wanted. It wasn't doing what I wanted to get money to do what I wanted. It was just, I was always just doing what I wanted. Mm-hmm. So I have this weird relationship with money. I'll spend, like, I don't calculate or compute. Like, I'll spend $80 on a, never mind, I don't want anyone hating me for how much money I would spend on something little. But
tell us.
So I was going to say a pair of fingernail clippers.
Hey, I would too.
Yeah, you would.
I love fingernail clippers. They're amazing. I'll go on Amazon, type in fingernail clippers, rank them from highest to lowest, and the most expensive one will be like $12. I'll be like, no, I need fingernail clippers.
More.
Yeah, because I just, this is the tool of tools. Okay.
Germany.
Okay, yeah. I mean, simple things like that. Or like a really nice stapler.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. Okay.
Okay.
So yeah, for me.
Yeah, look at this nonsense.
$200.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Well, this is a pack of 280.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That doesn't count.
I was like, those are like the ones I have.
I hustle.
Ronnie, there's a million doors you've opened where I should be asking follow-up questions like about your gym, how you pay your rent. I mean, there's some incredible follow-up questions that
we were just talking about CrossFit. Let me give you an example of just like manifesting things into reality.
Okay.
So I wasn't working. So I closed down Mean Streets. I had two CrossFit affiliates, Mean Streets and Smiley Streets. Smiley Streets, I closed down after I was living in one of my clients, which is also a manifestation. I was living in one of my clients' houses at the top of the Hollywood Hills. It was beautiful. It had, and I was living there all alone. He basically just gave me the house right before he sold it. And so I was living my dream, right? I just walked into the Lexus dealership and said, give me the nicest car here, and was able to buy it. And then a few months later, I was living at the house at the top of the hills with a pool that I could heat up to 103 degrees. Like, it was like a hot tub pool. And, you know, just the life. I didn't really have to work. Girls, whatever. Friends, everything was...
Health.
Perfect, yeah. Everything was perfect. And I was in this house with two gyms, right? I had two gyms. And I was just like, this
friends.
Isn't... Yeah, this isn't worth it. I don't want to continue working as much as I'm working to attain this. This.
So you saw the gyms as work?
Yeah, by this time. So, well, yeah. So I was seeing the route to get to this house, which I thought was my goal, as more work that I didn't want to do. And so this experience made me just like start separating. So I closed down Smiley Streets like 6 months before the lease was even up. I just closed it down and then just traveled for a year, basically 2 years. So that was three or four years ago.
And you left Mean Streets to your people to run.
Yeah, and then eventually Mean Streets closed, which is a whole background story that would just be wasting our time, why and how that closed. But essentially,
I doubt that, but it's another podcast.
Yeah,
I think.
Essentially, I created my gym's closing, and I haven't. I didn't really work out all of...
Do you still pay the affiliate fees? Or
last
you,
year.
Or
no,
you, so,
no.
So the name's free. I could get Mean Streets?
Yeah.
Okay. Make a note of that too. I'd like to get that.
I feel like Eric's already snagged it.
Yeah. Eric's going to just get...
I'll go to you next week.
Hey, that path that you've laid, if you hear footsteps behind you when you leave here, that's Eric. He's opening a gym, start focusing on colors.
Buying a Lexus.
Yeah.
So
Eric's addicted to the stock market. He ain't following your path. Okay.
How is the stock market doing right now?
Pretty bad.
Yeah, because things are changing. I'll welcome you when you come to the other side.
All right.
So,
you got to focus your energy a little bit harder on those reds, Eric. Okay.
from the red.
Maybe the greens.
So means you're traveling for two. Mean Streets closes. You've been traveling for 2 years.
No. That was while I still had the gyms. But anyways, I closed the gym, and then I've just been not working out, like. At all last year. I was just in bed reading all day long.
Well, I follow you on Instagram. You've been riding your unicycle.
Yeah, these are just posts, man. Like
you slackline. Greg Glassman says some amazing stuff about the slackline. He says it's not the slackline that's shaking, it's you that's shaking.
Yeah, the rope's not moving.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it?
Yeah. The
Scroll down. There's one in here that Matt needs to see before I wrap this up, because I got to wrap this up. But scroll down a little bit. You know which one I'm talking about, Matt?
Can't wait to learn. I think I do, but double check.
No. It's like six posts ago or seven posts ago. Wow,
oh,
is that fucking for real?
Are you wearing Vibrams?
I wore those for a few years solely. And they're good unicycling shoes. This is why I was wearing them all the time.
Can you go back to the main Instagram?
Great jean shorts.
Oh, yeah, fuck, we didn't even get to the jorts, motherfucker. Damn.
Still time.
We talked about deep shit. We should be talking about superficial shit. Keep going. There it is. You see it. You see it.
Oh, my God.
You see it.
That doesn't offend me in any way.
So
I see I missed some of it now that the screen's so big.
Oh, your scrotum is dangling below?
Yeah.
It looks like it's recovered from...
No one's reported you. So what is going on in this picture?
What is going on in this picture?
So remember earlier I said I didn't work out and I was still able to compete. After a while I had to figure out why that is. And I was through all my research I found out that there's more efficient ways to get fit than being in a gym.
And you had low testosterone.
Right.
What a fucking
so
complete slap in the face to everyone who's juicing.
So the sun, earth, air, and water. And if you want to add ether into that, you can add ether into that. But these are...
Is that this stuff?
It's the... Yeah. Or like the spiritual realm. The non-physical stuff that the physical reality sort of resides in.
Have you heard how Eckhart Tolle describes it?
So yeah, I mean, these really famous people, just for some reason, I never read their... I have some Eckhart Tolle books, but I'm just like busy reading this like other side
yeah,
stuff.
I saw your books. I never heard of your books. I got to get them. But he says it's not nothing, it's no thing.
Mm-hmm.
I just really like that.
Yeah, I like those.
Okay, flowers. So sorry, back to the pineapple and your cock and balls.
So
eggplant.
So
eggplant.
When I started doing all the research, I realized that the things that I was naturally doing, like being outside at the beach and just on the earth and just like relaxing, these things were actually making me fit enough to make it to CrossFit Regionals. Because I promise you, I wasn't training. And I would just somehow do the open well enough to get to regionals. And then I would go to regionals and participate and have fun. And it's because I do this. So what I'm doing here is I'm at a hot springs and I covered myself in mud. Because, and naked, of course. Because all the stuff that we do, the lights, like these lights are the same thing as eating fast food.
Are you fucking kidding me? These are expensive.
Right, but they're not the same as the sun.
Right, don't say like they're fast food though, please, Jesus.
So like the sun is...
How do you think we should do the show? You think I should just open up the windows?
We should do it outside.
We should also have vitamin D supplements.
Well, the sun... So I sun gaze every morning. I've been up since 4:30.
You sun gaze?
I drove down here from Healdsburg to make sure that I got to a place to look directly at the sun. For 33
That's
minutes.
Bad for your eyes.
So you think.
Right. My mom told me.
Right. Because it's probably good for you. Everything that they, in quotes, tell you is bad for you. There's a massive campaign against the sun. Massive. And there's a reason for that. They don't want us powerful, right? So the sun isn't just for seeing. That's what everyone thinks. The sun... I even don't think it's a burning ball of gas in the sky.
Uh-oh.
This is like, we've been wrong about the sun throughout all of history. And
what do you think it is? You think it's a sentient being?
Yes, and yes, I do. But that's a little bit maybe too outside the realm of acceptance for the audience here.
Okay.
So the more acceptable version would be that it, think about it more as electricity, which we don't, like it's an electric node that's connected to all the other stars in the galaxy, and the light that's flowing through these stars is more like the force of life that we call God or chi or whatever that we call this thing that makes us all up. This I'm getting distracted by these pictures. This is it. Like the star light is like this spectrum of energy that's coming off of our sun is what makes us all up. This is why we eat, right? We're eating the light that's in the vegetables. The vegetables hold the light and they combine it with earth, water, and air. This is like everything that we do is about light, earth, water, air. And so if you focus on those things, you can become superhuman, like superhuman. And just because we're in a CrossFit building, this is how I can just intend myself to be fit. So, yeah, I'd love to talk about the sun, but it's a long conversation.
Wait, what was a sentient being? Explain what a sentient being is.
Like, it's conscious.
Yeah.
So it's alive.
I mean, I would argue the sun is alive. It's a living thing. I don't know if I...
And it's aware, making...
It has awareness, I guess.
Oh, like, yeah. Like it has a cognitive space. Like it's making decisions.
That would make the assumption you're making decisions.
Yeah, that's a human... Yes, but the non-human version of what that means. Because from a human standpoint, we make decisions. And that's what consciousness is. But it's not really what consciousness is. Like plants are conscious and they're not... They are making decisions, but differently than us.
And right. People aren't really making decisions. They think they're making decisions to delude themselves.
Right. I'm trying to walk down the cave right now.
Okay. Different kind of
trying
awareness.
My hardest.
Right?
Yeah.
Don't tell me I'm right.
Yeah.
Don't tell me.
What? I mean, I think that humans in the version that we are right now, like the mammalian human, is just the natural progression of life. And that's dictated by light. So our star has planets. And on this particular planet, there is a race existing on the surface that is sort of made from a mixture of alien DNA and extraterrestrial DNA and the mammals that were here, right? That's what all the religions say, right? They came down from the heavens and blah, 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 blah. Made Adam and Eve to be their slaves. And I think that the human being takes this form around every star, right? So on different planets, we might have insectoid humans or avian humans or fish humans.
I read this book one time. I can't remember what it is. It's a massive book, and it's a whole fucking cosmology of the universe. But it basically says that aliens are harvesting us the same way we harvest cows, mm-hmm. but they're harvesting energy off of us, mm-hmm. and they do that in the form of energy, so that when we have emotion, we expel energy, and that the aliens are harvesting it. And there's a group of people who believe this. Have you heard this?
I mean, this is
what are they?
This is a version of any truth that you would say. Like you can take the construct of what you just said, break it down to its like components, and then
get Christianity.
Anybody says is the same thing as that. Hmm. Yeah, you can get Christianity out of that.
We're gonna wrap up here, but before we wrap up, one final question: why did you come here? Besides the fact that I begged you.
What does that mean?
I mean, I sent you like 3 or 4 DMs.
Yeah.
And I was like, just like bugging you over the last year. Hey, come on in, come on in. And like, I mean, you're doing shit. You got shit to do.
Yeah.
But I mean,
I don't really have explanations for the things that I do. I just read my reality. And it worked out that I was getting really excited to come here and see you. And when that sort of feeling starts popping up, that energetic cord gets in alignment with this reality that we are in right now, then I just follow that. So it's the excitement that I followed.
Did you enjoy this, Cara?
Yes.
Did you enjoy this, Matt?
Yeah.
You're not gonna like we walk out and be like that weird motherfucker. What the?
No, I felt a bit disconnected in the beginning, but maybe the last 2/3 of it, I've thoroughly enjoyed.
Yeah, we should just cut off the beginning.
What? Why?
I've been telling him lately, it's like slow roll. We just like
it. Really? You gotta get into it. You gotta just start going though.
That's how the conversation starts to evolve.
And people like the gross things. By gross, I mean like the, like where are you from? What ethnicity are you? I would agree with that. There's some truth. There's some.
The deeper stuff.
All right, Eric, edit that out.
Eric, did you enjoy this?
I did.
Eric's got a blueprint for life.
I'd love to have you back. I don't believe that you don't work out.
I was just saying we should delete the first part because so we can just add more onto.
Oh, just keep talking.
But we don't have to do that. No, I'm just.
We'll keep it. Then we'll do a part 2.
We would definitely do a part 2. So I had something that we've been parading a lot of Christians through here, and they have something called Jesus Punch, and I had some sort of punch awakening, and so someone gave me this book, and it was like holy crap, and it was just an amazing book, and I like it because it has a lot of pictures. Mm-hmm. I'm a picture guy, so I wanted to gift it to you. This is it's been sort of like something I've
a I recent love this awakening because I was somewhere where my, somebody had this
in my like 22 or 23.
Okay.
I looked for an explanation for many years, and I never got an explanation.
So this is why I came here. So
it was for the LaCroix. It was for the LaCroix.
So I'll let you finish what you're just saying, but
I'm done.
I
don't want anyone knowing that shit about me.
This book I really liked when I was looking at it. It was within the last few weeks, and I was like, I really want this book. I really want this book. Hmm. And I buy books all the time, but there's something that I do, which is like there's certain things that I know will just come to me. So I don't try for them. And this book was one of those things.
Really?
Yeah. I was just looking at it and I was just like, I really want it. And then I stopped there. I don't think in my head, I'm going to make this exist. But I know I didn't act on getting it because it was going to come to me anyways.
I think the world is like that for everyone. You've just become aware of it.
I agree with that. Definitely.
Well, I mean, it's a kind of a common adage, right? If you want something, attract that thing to you. I mean, that's just my way of looking at what I think is your approach.
Ronnie, thank you.
Thank you, guys.